sure that we have time to catch up during this public break and then the rest of the conversation after. Now, let me introduce our second speaker to you, Professor Mori. He is currently an associate professor with the Graduate School of Global Environmental Studies at Kyoto University, and he got his PhD in Economics and Global Environmental Studies. And today he is going to talk about how Chinese government is moving towards a more sustainable energy future. Okay, without further ado, please join me to welcome Professor Mori.
Last Congress of East Asian Association for Environmental Research. I'm serving as a Secretary General for the association. So she presented one paper at the Congress, and so also I attended. So she is the only participant from Hong Kong in the association Congress. And I'm afraid she is the only member from Hong Kong. If she accepts there, so we will hold the association Congress in Hong Kong in the future.
Sure.
So last year we held that Congress in Fukuoka in Japan. And this because this is the East Asian Association. So we are holding several cities in Asia. In the past several years, we held it in, for example, Taipei and Fukuoka, and this year in Singapore. And next year or the year after the next, we hold it in China or Hong Kong, depending upon the Chinese elections. Because I keep silence for the discussion in the last presentation. So political economy of energy transition is one of my research interests, especially so that you mentioned legacy is one of the my research concern. So today I will focus on the kind of political economy of energy transition in China. But I conducted the same research for targeting in Japan. While it was more than 1 year long review process, so not yet published. Anyway, when I replied to several questions you raised, we should focus on we should focus on nuclear power in Japan because as a legacy of the past dependence in when we consider the transition to energy transition because even after the Fukushima disaster the government, not only the government but several local governments and also manufacturers stick to nuclear power. That's why, especially LDP or the current government is try to recover or recommission the nuclear power. Even though the amount of renewable energy, especially solar power, is increasing. and also the Ministry of Ministry of Economy is also want to revive the nuclear power as a, first as a part of energy security, and also to want to keep the electricity price low for industry. So, and also that's why, as Professor Yarin said, the Ministry of Economy want to control or want to replace the emergency of solar power. So to protect the incumbent electric power industries, and also that hurt grid needs. You are right that if the Japanese government or Japanese independent power companies increase their supply for the renewable energy, then existing or incumbent electric power companies will lose. Especially cannot keep with transmission or grid connection. So that's why the ministry don't want to increase the renewable energy. That's part of it. And they have a very big political power. So it is very in contrast with China. So when we talked about, discussed about this issue, many Chinese researchers asked me, in China, government decide, and then, of course, the company, especially the national oil companies, may have some influence to the government policy, but government decide. While in Japan, many power companies have a big power, big political power to influence the policy side. So that's part of the reason that when we see the speed or progress of energy transition, Chinese researcher looks Japanese progress so slow and compared to China. But that's why I'm also focused on the Chinese transition, energy transition. And I make analysis in view of politics. This is the content. So my focus is more on this analysis. So background. I suppose all of you know about the carbon emissions in China, and now growth of carbon emissions is much more slow. And especially from the emission from coal is slower, and in some it is reducing. So behind, we assume this is because it's focus on carbon emission, so we tend to focus on climate policies. So some of you conduct research on smart city or low carbon development. And also, from 2009, Chinese government started several carbon policies, carbon reduction policies, and demonstration policies. And so this year, Chinese government committed to implement nationwide carbon emission credit scheme. So that will effective to reduce much more carbon emissions. So in our analysis, we are sure that also China has already committed to peak out the carbon emission by 2030. But in our analysis, China can peak out much earlier than 2050, and cost is much lower than we anticipated, around $6-$7 per car. This is the marginal cost of carbon reduction to peak out carbon emission in China by 2030. So if earlier, then the cost may be so higher, but if not, so the so in our analysis, so the marginal cost of marginal benefit cost is much lower than so if, why? So we have already several researches. So mostly, so it's not, so most of the researches mentioned, it's not a carbon policy, but the energy policy or energy target, especially energy intensive target. And also it's not, so this is just a policy target, but actually, so renewable energy, especially wind and solar, has emerged a lot. And provides or government to play a very significant role in the emergence. While so there are several, so quite a difference in the winner, so emergency wind solar. And if we talk about so renewable energy itself is good, but if we talk about the linkage between the ETS, so emission trading scheme, then increase in renewables may allow non-carbon sector to increase their carbon emission. Because renewable energy allows these companies to discharge more, because renewable energy will reduce carbon emission. So they say it's a kind of renewable energy can cause a carbon leakage. So in several researches, they say so even though such as energy transitions or energy progressing energy policies, so we cannot see any improvement in energy security. So they say no improvement. But in other words, they say these energy transitions doesn't work the energy security well. So in my previous research on the legacy or historical perspective, so I'm quite wondering how to recognize these transitions and how to foresee future transition. In the past, or still now, in my understanding, Chinese government place first priority of economic growth still. And then, energy policy, or energy security, or energy supply is important to support this high-speed economic growth. That's why, for Chinese government, energy security is indispensable. So I'm wondering if how Chinese government is reconcile the climate change requirement with energy security or abundance of energy supply to support economic growth. So this is one of the questions. And also, if we talk about historical development, we should talk about the whole also. So China is characterized, or Chinese energy is characterized by coal and coal dependence. So here, they say, according to the statistics, coal production or coal consumption is reducing recently. But this may raise a conflict of interest within the coal industry or coal power and renewables. So that might be a barrier. So in my perspective, that might be a barrier to energy transition. So my second research question is, what is the enabling factors, or how Chinese government or China is overcoming the barriers to transition to energy regime, especially how to reconcile how to minimize the conflict of interest of coal industry This is also on the second. So when this so make this analysis, so I employ the so what you so already so shown the so multinational perspective of system integration. So I suppose so all of you have already shared so this kind of map. And so while this is so just a holistic picture, so I'd like to so put it more in detail to make analysis. So several researches make the type of so classified disaggregated the transition into several types of this transformation, realignment, and reconfiguration. And so these are so if we talk about the energy electricity system, so transformation is so means so acceptance of increasing amount of work, and so realignment means also more competition between the incumbents in meaning also fuel based coal or fuel based power and renewables and reconfiguration as a decentralized energy system or region wide system. So by disaggregating typology, some researchers want to prospect which directions to go in the energy transition in several countries. While so I'd like to further step to make us analysis in view of political. So I'd like to add market competition and power relation and interpretation as also analytical as well. I'm afraid most of you have already know shared China energy conditions. But to wrap up development. When we talk about China, when we say in a research on the multilateral perspective, multi-level perspective, they, especially European, European researchers, place much focus on the bottom-up niche innovation. Instead of landscape, this niche development is how the niche development is going to regime. And so, in some cases, landscape development, destabilize the regime to pick up rich development, to keep or to seek the regime. This is the basic concept of multilateral perspective in my understanding. But when we talk about the change in Asia, landscape development has a significant impact. Instead of niche innovation at the bottom. Of course, we can find many bottom-up or niche development. But landscape, we have to focus first on landscape development, then to bottom-up and niche development. So in case of China, of course, we have to find several developments. First is the power shortage in the last decade. And then how to recover energy security. This is the main topic in the last decade. And then going to the shift to the climate issues. And also now Chinese government pay much more attention to air pollution. So this is the main development in the landscape. And so the policy of course also is affected by these. In terms of electricity shortage, because in the past data, we can find much more serious power shortage, but after the collection of statistical data, we can see so much power shortage in this area, in this period, but still, So in this period, China has has suffered from power shortage, especially in many areas. So many industries have installed their power generation in their company, in their facilities. While there, so first the government addressed this power shortage by saving and efficiency. So during the 5-year plan period, the government implemented several policies and also reduction target. But also during that period or before that period, Chinese government negotiated with several energy, potential energy exporting countries or energy production companies to import not only gas, not only oil, but also gas. So this is also example of pipeline gas, or the contract for pipeline gas from the surrounding countries in China, including Myanmar, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Russia. So you can find China has already contracted so many amount of pipeline gas from surrounding countries. And you can find from Myanmar, China can obtain pipeline gas to southern China, including Guangdong. And from Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan, central China, they provide pipeline gas to central China, including Shanghai. And finally, from Russia, after the long negotiation, they agreed to provide gas to northern China, including Beijing. So we can assume that pipeline gas import, Chinese government or major city in China can easily change the switch the energy from coal or coal to gas. And of course, besides the pipeline gas, China has also imported LNG from Indonesia, Australia, and several countries. And because of this, energy import in China has much increased during, especially from 2008, 2009, after the economic crisis. And this, of course, enabled China to reduce carbon emissions well. And so in terms of technology, also CDM is one of the provided motivation for China to invest in carbon reduction. So China, as you may know, China is top receiver of CDM project, and so gained a lot of carbon, lots of investment, and so gained a lot of carbon reduction in the process. And during the process, among these more than 1,600 projects, half of them are small power, small hydro, followed by wind and methane gas. So in the process, Chinese wind power project, wind power developers get to know how to pay back from these carbon reduction projects. Besides, Chinese government initiated several national projects to develop especially wind power. Most attention is the first one. Government initiated the national development project for wind power and implemented auction while with the higher amount of local content requirement, so that so foster the Chinese wind turbine manufacturers, and then implemented the mandatory practice and RPAs and then feeding tariffs and applied to solar power. So because of this, even in 2011, Chinese wind turbine manufacturers shares four manufacturers share top 10 and total amount exceeds 20% in this period, and now more than 30% of the world share. And also, China has the largest wind power installation in the world. The solar, PV module and solar power. So at the time of 2012, five Chinese companies share the top 10, and now shares around half, majority, more than half of the world production, world supply of solar power, module and panels. After implementing feed-in tariff, I'm not so good at operating this. China increased the installation capacity of solar power and exceeded Germany in 2015. So that's why the share of renewables in primary energy supply as well as electricity has jumped up during these 5-6 years. We are going into the analysis why China allows renewable energy to develop so much, and also why China accepts so much energy while in the past sense we assume energy import threatens energy security. This is also, I suppose, it's also kind of traditional interpretation of energy security. But Chinese government changed this interpretation as additional development oil and gas around the world by Chinese companies as enhancing. So that contributes to enhance energy security of China because it increased global energy security. Mm. Mm. So that implies that China will increase energy import from several countries, but keep the energy import or energy consumption of other countries. So Chinese development is additional, not only China but all over. This is the interpretation of Chinese government. So with this recognition, increasing energy import is not the threat to their energy. This is the idea of Chinese government. And climate change, before CDA, Chinese government regarded as a barrier to economic development. So they don't want to have any obligation for carbon reduction. But through the experience of CDM, they recognize, the Chinese government recognized that we can make climate change as an issue of development for new industrial development, especially renewable energy. So the Chinese government, bigger region of energy, as a creating new growth point. So, and so renewable energy is of course a new technology and so easily catch up with developed countries. So, Chinese government, no. So, provide so many subsidies and provide initiate a national project to foster renewable energy manufacturing. And finally, air pollution. So, because so in the past, of course, so Chinese government, China has suffered from air pollution, serious air pollution for a long time. But after, especially 2011 and 2013, when the so U.S. Embassy released serious air pollution in China, in Beijing, then government recognized so air pollution as a shaking of the legitimacy of the government. So the government has to strictly control the air pollution. This is a recognition. So the government make it as a mandate to reduce air pollution as well. And so bring the reduction of air pollution in carbon, in climate change or carbon emission reduction. And then, so how about the market competitive or business? So manufacturers, so renewable manufacturers, so made a cost down by competition and cheap labor and technology supply. So they find many so cheap and good technology suppliers. And through learning by doing, so they enjoy the so cost down. And also, so many companies so enjoy the cheap and substantial. So this is also one of the issues that so many so Chinese companies join this market and so foreign company foreign government. And also so Chinese companies could capitalize on the development of renewable energy policy in other countries to increase their production. And also, so Chinese companies capitalize on the so competition among foreign companies to merge and acquire the foreign companies that lost in competition and get technology from these companies. So this is so one of the examples of solar power. So actually, because solar power or solar module is can be regarded as a niche innovation in China, because it is a Chinese private company that develop and emerge and develop the solar panel, not the government initiative. And of course, several city governments, such as Wuxi government, city government, provided much of the financial support to the company, especially this Suntec. And so there is the government support from the local level, but not the national level. But in the end, national government provide, not national government, now so Chinese development bank provided a huge amount of support to these companies for their export. So compete with foreign companies. So that's why United States and European Union, because they are suffering from the huge cut through competition, so in the end, important to protect themselves. So, finally, we should focus on power relations. So, in the multilateral perspective, we find niche innovation in the bottom level and then going to regional. But in China, and so, while so, there is a so, so niche developer or niche innovator find a so conflict between the regime or incumbents. Of course, there is a so, so conflict of interest between the so renewables and or niche innovators and so incumbents, especially coal mines and coal farms. But so here, so Chinese government, of course, also support and provide support and provide assistance to these renewable manufacturers and renewable energy developers. And Chinese government provide so invest in so grid company and so transmission lines in so during the global global crisis. And so government support the emergence of renewable energy. While so local government, because so they have much revenue from coal miners, local coal miners, local powers, local government want to support these companies. But the central government so put the responsibility for emissions and also so order shutdown of the small coal powers and miners. While so benefit provide benefit for their technological upgrade. So the government, central government, so divide the so large companies and small local companies and provide benefit to local large companies while so discourage these small and local companies. But even so, even large companies will lose from this game. That's why Chinese, so under the name of, in the name of One Belt,
One Road,
so, right? So Chinese government, so Chinese Development Bank, Exim Bank, so provide massive financial support for their foreign investment to relieve or to, so, to make them so foreign business. So that's, so that's the way that so China or Chinese government so mitigate the conflict of interest between the emerging innovators and incumbents. So, of course, there are several sufferers or losers, such as so coal mines in several countries, in several cities. But and so, so many, especially so, so hundreds of thousands of people so lost jobs in these coal mines. But still, so despite of this, so Chinese government, central government, so implement this, and still in the local level, there is a conflict of interest over the local grid, because so especially the northern area, so local provider, so power provider, so coal and heat provider, so the coal power changed them into the so coal and heat provider, and northern area. So people need heat instead of power. But so coal and heat power provide both coal and heat. And winter time, as in Europe, so they have much wind. So wind power also provides lots of energy. So in the winter time, so there is a conflict over the local grid. So which actor should supply the energy? Local level, local government, of course, prioritize their local coal and local power. So we can see huge amount of cartel in the winter time in northern China. It amounts to worse. And so Chinese government, have lots of so implemented lots of policies, and especially this so scrap of domestic coal production capacity is have a significant increase to the coal price. And it's okay to reduce coal consumption, but it will generate inflation and so destabilize economic activity and consumer. So still, so the Chinese government have to make a balance between the So coal production, coal consumption, and price, and consumer rate. This is so new or additional challenge that should be overcome. And so I'm still wondering if so these market-based policies can so render to overcome these policies. I'd like to discuss this issue. So this is a conclusion. First, so but because of time, I'd like to just show and want to so continue the discussion. So thank you very much.
Yeah. Highlighting all these very important issues for China. So we, I think we have time to take two or three questions.
Thank you very much. Just 2 months ago, I attended the workshop on Belt and Road Initiative organized by Chinese Investment Hong Kong, and I was participating in a session on energy for the Belt and Road Initiative. And according to your argument, that so probably the central government tried to somehow encourage these coal mining companies and probably cement and other companies with excess capacity to try to make investment in all these countries along the Belt and Road so that they could somehow mitigate the kind of negative impact from all these policy changes within the country. And is there any possibility that rather than doing so, that renewable investment could be made in these countries?
I see.
So I'm just curious which direction to go. I think that has a huge implication for globally speaking.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Renewable developers have already invested some of them are in line with One Belt One Road, but even without One Belt One Road, so several companies have already invested in several Asian countries as well as African countries. Especially so Chinese companies are very good at standard type wind and solar. While also Japanese companies stick to grid connection. So we can find and also in many countries in the rural area or many countries that suffer from power shortage, they like it. They want to invite Chinese renewable developers to install standard on time. So if standard on time, then it doesn't cause any serious conflict with incumbents of their national power developers. So that's why we can find many cases. But if we talk, because it's a standard type and small scale, so the impact should be much smaller if we compare it with coal power, investment in coal power, that amount 300 megawatts or 600 megawatts.
Basically, Chinese government is supporting coal-based power system rather than renewables. To go to other countries and make investment, at least at the policy level.
If we see the financial support from Chinese Development Bank or Chinese Exim Bank or Chinese Investment Bank, definitely.
Development strategy action plan. So the government, the Chinese government, actually has been promoting a policy to use more natural gas to reduce the reliance on coal consumption to address the air quality problems. So based on the landscape, based on the energy landscape of China right now, so do you think it's a good idea to use more gas and to reduce the coal consumption and probably as a bridge towards a new renewable energy in the future?
So, So as also so transit so anyway so so until the so renewable energy covers so most of massive or most of the so energy supply, so we have to rely on natural gas as a transitional energy at least. So it's not so so we like or not. We have to rely to reduce coal consumption. So that's my idea. But still, even so, so we have to consider the price gap between the coal and gas. So, so I suppose so only few power plants use gas as their so power production because of high price. So, so now so several industries such as cement, steel, and iron, several industries so consume their so change their fuel to coal to gas, but not so much for no, power generation because of the price. So this is also so so I suppose so as a transition it's good to change from switch from coal to gas. Also instead of renewable so until the renewables can cover all. But still, we have several so barriers for such a few research.
Okay, thanks a lot. Yeah, I think it's a good time to talk to you. Thanks again, Professor Mori, for bringing us to the good understanding of Chinese context. Now, perfect time for us to move on to our third talk today, and we will have a change of the venue upstairs, one stair. And then now, follow our staff members and then we'll show you the way. And we'll have a change of venue. Okay, thank you very much. You can, coffee is also served upstairs, but you can also bring some upstairs. Thanks a lot. Yeah. And we can continue the conversation upstairs. Thank you so much.
I should.